The main challenge in creating usable AI agents is ensuring that they are reliable in production. And this is exactly what Instructor aims to solve. By combining function calls with a data validation library called Pydantic, Jason Liu has solved the unsolvable problem of model hallucinations. Instructor is the only library that I consistently use in production as an AI developer, and in this video I will show you exactly how you can use it too to make your agents more reliable, accurate, and safe. I will also share some updates on my own framework called Agency Swarm and some exciting highlights from our recent call with Jason at the end of this video. Let's get started. Open up your PC and grab the notebook from the description right now. Let's install the Instructor package along with a few more packages imported and call our first and the most important method in this tutorial, which is instructor.patch function. This method will connect your OpenAI client to a newer version called QStar. After that, you will not ever have to prompt your model again because it will be prompting you instead. But seriously, although probably not as powerful as QStar, this method does add some additional functionality to your OpenAI client, which I'm going to show you soon. Let's try to create our first basic model called user detail with the name and age parameters. You can add descriptions to this model as standard Python doc strings, which will then be passed into the OpenAI function calling schema. This means that based on your doc strings, the model will determine how to use your functions. As I mentioned before, this is a super convenient and smart way to do this because it makes your code a lot cleaner and easier to maintain. Simply insert this model into a new response model parameter, which was created by the patch function earlier on your OpenAI client. Make sure to also set the type of the user to user detail. Then run the OpenAI chat completions create method, and now the user variable will contain name and age type parameters, which you can access with autocompletes directly from your code editor. This library uses function calling under the hood to populate your data model. Therefore, user will now be guaranteed to have both name and age parameters as strings. Otherwise, it will cause an error. This is actually a good thing because throwing an error early in production is much safer than relying on AI to return the correct values. I will show you in a bit how you can also allow the model to correct itself. But for now, let's proceed with the next section, which is understanding fields. To make some of your parameters optional, all you have to do is provide a default value or a default factory value. The only difference is that default factory takes a function, which allows you to set the default programmatically. Alternatively, you can wrap your parameters into the optional type from typing library. To make your model even more accurate, you should always add descriptions, titles, and examples in each of the fields, or even use JSON schema extra to set them all at once. Again, those will be passed to GPT through parameter descriptions in your function schema, so make sure you provide enough context for the model on how to work with your functions. There is a variety of available types in both Pydantic and typing packages that you can use with Instructor. For example, email takes a special type from Pydantic called email string. By doing so, you can ensure that the returned value from your model will always be a valid email, which is super handy. Now comes the interesting part, which is automatic validation. I'm going to create a refund details model with customer name and amount fields. Imagine that you don't want to allow GPT to make refunds over $100. We're going to create a special method called validate amount with a field validator and class method decorators. Now, before initializing this data model, Pydantic will automatically run this function so you can verify the value V generated by the model for this parameter. In a real-world scenario, you would compare this amount with the amount of the latest order from this customer in your database. However, to keep things simple, we are just going to check if it's less than 100. Next, I'm going to send a message to the model stating that I am Arseny and that I want a refund for $1,000, like I made a typo or something. As you can see, I immediately get an error, so the refund is incomplete. However, if I still want the model to perform the refund for the correct amount, what I can do is add an additional parameter that was added by the patch function called max retries and set it to 2. Now the model will look at our error message that we defined in our validator function above and immediately correct itself. As you can see below, the amount and the customer name are now both correct without any errors. But it doesn't end here. With the instructor, we can take it a step farther and perform validation using another language model. Yes, you've heard that right. By wrapping our type in annotated and then employing a before validator with the LLM validator function from the instructor, we can actually verify whether the answer contains any objectionable things as determined by another GPT. So, for example, if our context says that the meaning of life is to live a life of sin and debauchery, the model will now return an error. However, if we set the max retries parameter to 2 again, it will correct itself and state that the meaning of life is actually to seek happiness and fulfillment. Of course it is. Now, to convert your model to OpenAI schema, all you have to do is replace the base model with the OpenAI schema class imported from Instructor. Then you can add additional methods like run or execute and define your logic inside. To use it with the new OpenAI API, simply pass it into the tools parameter using the OpenAI schema property. The type should be set to function. I added a special method here for your convenience that checks and executes all your tools from the function calls. So all you have to do is just simply iterate over all tool calls in the message and run this function. It will automatically validate all the data from GPT and execute these functions. All the same techniques that we discussed before apply to tools defined with the OpenAI schema in the same way. Now, if you are still not impressed by this, Jason has a few more cool prompting tricks and tips that you could use to significantly improve the quality of your GPT responses. First, to avoid even more unexpected errors, you can always include other options in literal or enumerator types. This will allow GPT to categorize unexpected outputs, which often occur in production, into separate categories without causing any errors. Next, you can include a chain of thought or instruction parameters inside your function calls, which will allow the model to plan its actions or repeat its own instructions for better performance on complex functions without using a chain of thought globally. This allows you to significantly save on token costs and latency. Additionally, you can set the exclude parameter to true to omit these fields from your data model, as you're unlikely to use them in your logic anyways. And lastly, you can wrap your data models inside other data models, significantly improving your code structure and quality for complex tools. This allows you to reuse your models and easily define relationships between entities. Now, as I said before, my own library, Agency Swarm, actually depends on Instructor for all tool definitions. The only difference here is that you need to extend the base tool and also implement a run method, which is what the agent will execute when calling your function. I do recommend that you always define your functions and logic yourself. However, as I promised, I recently added a tool factory class that now allows you to import any LangChain tools in just one line of code. Keep in mind, however, that LangChain has very poor function descriptions because they released their tools before OpenAI released function calling feature. Still, this might be enough for those who just want to test my framework before implementing their own logic. Finally, let's go over one last real-world example on how to add accurate citations to your RAG chatbot. This is super useful for model explainability and also increases the accuracy of your responses. We're going to start with a class called fact, which will take a fact as a string and a list of substring quotes. Then it will run an after validator, which will check these quotes against our own context. The getSpans and getSpan method essentially verify that all the substring quotes are contained within our context. Now, our other class will be called questionAnswer, and it will essentially force GPT to repeat the question and also return a list of facts. In the validator of this class, we will combine all the answers from all the facts that have at least one verified substring quote. To pass your context, use the validation context parameter that was also added by the instructor patch function. That's it. Now we can run the OpenAI API with an example question and context and instantly receive an answer along with a list of facts and verified quotes from the text. I have personally come across many use cases where such functionality was essential for my clients, and without Instructor, this would be extremely challenging and time-consuming to implement. For more cool examples, make sure to check out the Instructor cookbook and documentation. Now, let's move on to the highlights with Jason Liu himself. All right, Jason, thank you so much for joining. Can you please share with us a little bit about yourself, your background, and what you do?
So right now I'm operating as an AI consultant, helping a lot of VCs and early stage companies sort of organize their AI strategy and also sort of help do some research and prototyping. My background is in computational mathematics, and in the past 6 years I've been working as a machine learning engineer at a company called Stitch Fix. But now I just primarily do consulting. In the past year, I was supposed to take a year off of work, but almost 3 months after my little vacation, ChatGPT came out, and then I just had more and more people requesting me to help think about how to work with AI and make their processes a lot more efficient.
I'm in the exact same situation. As soon as ChatGPT came out, it's been absolutely crazy. So could you please talk more about your library instructor and what is your vision for this open source project?
I would say for the most part, when I was using some of the frameworks that existed before Instructor, I found that really all I needed to do was two things really well. I wanted to get structured data out because eventually I want to build systems that communicate with other systems rather than chatbots. And two, I wanted to have complete access over my prompts. And I felt a lot of other libraries sort of wrote all the prompts for you, which means it's really easy to get started. But it also means, you know, 2 months, 6 months into a project, you have to do a lot of more work to sort of undo all of the written stuff that people have been building. When OpenAI function calling came out, that was an opportunity where I just realized, okay, well, now they take JSON schema. But JSON schema is really painful to write. Let me use Pydantic. And then I realized that we had all these new ways of prompting and working with these language models.
Is there any specific reason why you decided to do this library specifically for OpenAI models with function calling rather than, you know, using it with all open source models as well?
Yeah, so there's two reasons. One of them is the fact that when you use OpenAI models, you just use the ones that are the best. And most of the stuff I've been doing with my clients are really making sure that these systems are production ready. And so, you know, running with local models is cool to do it on your laptop, but what you find is, one, they're not smart enough, and two, when you go from your laptop to actually hosting them for inference, that becomes incredibly difficult.
Yeah.
The second reason is when you use function calling, the prompts that you write only encapsulate the instructions, and all the description of the output you want back out goes in that function calling arguments. And what that means is that we have really good separation with the prompts that we want to use for the structure and the prompts we want to use for the instructions. And again, this means that I don't have to write the prompts for you.
It looks like people don't seem to realize that function calling models are fundamentally different from the open source models, because OpenAI has actually trained these models to call functions. It means like the functions were in their training data. It's not like you're prompting the model to call some function, and that's why we see this, like, you know, huge prompts in LangChain. But the function calling models, you don't have to explain anything to them. They already know that they can call functions. So yeah, from the OpenAI Dev Day, what are your thoughts and what are you most excited about?
So the big one that's related to the work that I've been doing is the fact that now we have something like JSON mode, which means that we have a higher likelihood that the JSON that we get out of function calling is syntactically correct JSON. I'm actually personally pretty excited about this idea of not only having this GPT app store, but having the revenue sharing. I'm really excited. Yeah. Now that there are better incentives for people to build very powerful tools, I'm really curious to see what are the things that will end up popping up first in the store. Especially because, you know, in the past, when I had to build GPT apps, I would have to learn how to write front-end code. I would just spin up a database to manage these threads. And now OpenAI handles that all for me. And so the barrier to entry is even lower than before, even though it was already so low. And so I think creativity is the only limiting factor now for people to build with these systems.
Yeah, exactly. But how do you plan to adapt Instructor for this new feature for the JSON outputs? I know that they also renamed the functions into tools, and now they have like their own assistance API, which already formats all the outputs for you. Mm-hmm. So how do you plan to integrate all these changes into Instructor?
Yeah, for the most part, I don't think I have to. I think most of the usage for Instructor is this like very straightforward, simple application of having structured data back out. I think tools that will take advantage of these assistant type APIs will be tools like Marvin, where they're incentivized to build out a lot of this thread capabilities, have these different assistants, whereas Instructor will be mostly focused on having these structured data workflows and fine-tuning models to make use of the structured outputs. Because I think one of the big goals is, you know, a lot of us aren't building assistants, we aren't building chatbots, we're just building tools that communicate between one API to another.
So what's your take on AutoGen, on agent swarms, and all these agent frameworks?
Yeah, I think for the most part, my biggest concern is making sure that we don't regret any decisions that we make. And my concern when using some of these tools like Guidance and AutoGen really has been the fact that when they're supported by research, we don't really know how long these tools will last in the long run. Right? I think Guidance already is sort of like slowly being deprecated out of many systems. I think they're really incredibly exciting frameworks, and I think we can learn a lot from how these things are being built. But I'll be really excited if, you know, Microsoft came out and said, oh, this is something we're going to support in the next like 4 to 5 years. That will give us a lot more confidence in using these tools to begin with.
So have you ever used LangChain or AutoGen or any of these frameworks in production?
So I've tried LangChain and AutoGen when they came out, but I would say for the most part, we're not really building very complex agents, right? We're mostly building workflows. And what that means is, in order to get the best performance out of these systems, we want to know exactly what are the prompts that we're sending. We want to be able to control that in a very fine-grained level and know even exactly how many API calls we're making. Mm-hmm. In like an e-commerce situation, 200 milliseconds of lag or any kind of latency will lose you like 1% of revenue. And so we really care about how to maximize the latency of these systems and know exactly what's going on.
So in the future, do you think that we will achieve AGI with one super intelligent model, or will it be like 1,000 smaller agent models all running together in some system?
Yeah, so I am on the boat of, you know, this like multi-phase thing, right? So one, I think we're going to get one big super intelligence. And then as that technology gets like perforated, we're going to go into a world where we actually want to have many, many agents, right? I think this is mostly because of like how like our own brains work. Like, we want to have different boundaries. Like, we don't actually want to have one person in our life be our secretary and our chef and our best friend and my therapist, right? Like, humans want this many, many people in their life, right? We're social creatures. And I think just as a result of the fact that we as humans want many people in our lives, I think we as humans want to have many super intelligence, and we'll be able to sort of create boundaries. Whether it is one super intelligence acting like 20 people or if it's actually 20 different systems, I don't think that really matters. But I think for the most part, we will want many systems simply because that's how our brains work. So I think in any system, I think defining boundaries is a pretty good way of reducing the cognitive load for either developer or the language model.
I guess we'll have to see what happens next.
Yeah.
After the OpenAI Dev Day, I'm personally going to be developing a lot of cool projects and posting them on my channel. I'm already working on a project that will combine Instructor and the new OpenAI APIs. So definitely stay tuned for that. And lastly, where can people find out more about you and your work?
Yeah, so if you go on Twitter, I am JXNLCO. Hopefully there's like a banner somewhere. And then the only other place you would look is probably the documentation of Instructor. Instructor is a very lightweight library. Most of my goals are actually to improve the documentation and mostly teach people how to think about prompting function calling rather than necessarily having to use my library. Right? Using Pydantic is something you can do in like Marvin, LangChain, Llama Index, wherever. But these tools for prompting with structured data is something that I think will be very valuable for a lot of people.
Awesome. Thank you so much for coming out, Jason. And good luck with your library instructor. I hope that people will contribute, and I certainly will. So thank you.
Great. Thank you for having me. Pleasure.